You got questions, I got answers, maybe. Hey guys and gals and everyone in between, thanks for coming back to my channel. Welcome to this question and answer video. This is the first time I'm doing this on the channel. It's also been a long time since I've done something unscripted, as they tend to take forever in post, but I'm gonna risk it and we're gonna see what happens today. I thought it would be fun to go through some of my more popular videos, look at some of the questions that I seem to get most frequently, and address them here in this video. I found that a lot of the questions you guys asked, I've covered a little bit in the past, or I actually plan on doing a full video on in the future. But for now, I thought instead of doing something scripted, I'd just read the questions, react to them, and let you know what's going on in this head of mine. So anyway, what I did was I went through my top 8 videos and I picked questions that I thought you guys would like to hear the answers to, more or less. And we're just gonna wing it. We're gonna go through these one at a time. I think I've got about 13 questions. Some of these I think I can answer pretty quickly, and the others, hopefully, I'll have something informative to say. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go through and I'm going to let you guys know which video these questions are from. We're just gonna use initials, as I don't know if these people would want their names blasted out in this video. And let's just jump right into it. The first one is from JL, and this is from my video, Are You One of the 1% with OCPD? And their question is, hey mate, I wondered if you have encountered any trouble with risk taking or people telling you that you don't take any risks in general, etc., and wondered if you would mind sharing your experience of this. So I don't experience this particular symptom, I guess you would call it. I do have trouble, and a lot of people with OCPD have trouble pulling the trigger on things or getting things done or sticking with them due to the common perfectionist mentality that a lot of us have. So for example, if I wanted to play the guitar and I started and I did not progress as quickly as I wanted to, and 99 times out of 100 that's gonna be the case, I'm just gonna give up. So that's not necessarily taking a risk, but it is holding back in life and not doing the things that you want to do because of a fear of failure. So it's not really, I guess it is a little bit that, but I don't really see it as a danger risk type of situation. More of, I just don't want to humiliate myself, or I don't want to fail in a way that I would see as unacceptable. So let's move on to the next question. This is from the same video, Are You One of the 1% with OCPD? And this is from CH. I recently heard about OCPD and immediately thought of my boyfriend. I found your channel while trying to gather more info on this disorder. This video brought me to tears while you were explaining the pain people with OCPD go through, as well as the pain they cause to the people who love them the most. But how the hell am I going to convince him he may have this disorder? He is so damn stubborn, and whenever I try to express that this behavior is hurtful, he makes me feel like I am crazy. So this is a tricky one. This is a question that I get asked a lot. This is something that comes up in the groups and in the forums. It is something a lot of people don't have success with. And I'm gonna give you my opinion, and that is that if you wanna reach this person, you're gonna have to do so as gently as possible. I know that you're the one that's dealing with all of the grief. You're the one that is having to bear a lot of the burdens in the relationship, but if you want to reach this person, you're gonna have to do so in a very, very gentle, loving, and patient way, and there's no other way around it. If you get them to jump on the defense, then you've lost already. So I think presenting it to them in chunks and letting them sit with it and talking to them in a rational and logical way, take feelings out. A lot of the times, people with OCPD use the logical side of their brain more than the emotional responses that you might be used to. Come at them logically, come at them gently, and be prepared for it to take time, and do not throw OCPD out there right away. Just talk about the individual things that they're doing, and over time, you might be able to present this idea to them, and even further down the road, maybe get them into therapy or agree to go to couples therapy together. And again, this deserves a whole video, and I will do that sometime soon. Hopefully that gives you some tools to approach the person. The next up is from NB, from I Have OCPD and I'm an Asshole. And this is, do you find your anxiety to be circular? And if so, how do you break out of the cycle? I think by its nature, if you have an anxiety disorder or an anxiety problem, it is cyclical, it is circular. So for most people, when they have a fear response, they might have a spike in their anxiety, and that's where the heart rate's gonna go up, and you're going to be sweaty and you're going to have an upset feeling in your stomach and a whole host of other symptoms. And then you're going to come back down and return to earth and feel better within a relatively short amount of time. People with an anxiety disorder experience those symptoms, and then the brain continuously feeds this loop of I don't feel well, so something must be wrong, and something must be wrong, so I don't feel well, and so you just stay up. Breaking this, I think, requires mindfulness, meditation, getting somewhere quiet, and reasoning your way through the situation. 99% of the time, it's not as bad as you think it is, and you just need to convince your brain. And once your brain is convinced, then those symptoms will subside. If you really do have a problem, though, you should be going and seeing a professional. And that's going to be the case of most of these questions. I'm not a doctor. I don't claim to be a doctor. And you're going to benefit the most from going and getting some treatment. But there are techniques online. You can look them up. There are things that you can do to lower the anxiety. Okay, so that one was a little heavy. Let's move on to something a little bit lighter. This is from TA, from the same Me Being an Asshole video. I'm not sure if anyone can answer this, but would one be a conscientious type if they did this, for example? And this is the example they give. If a clean shirt touches a dirty shirt they believe to be contaminated, they will want to wash it. But at the same time, they don't want to be obsessively particular to the point where they alter normal behavior, so they force themselves to fold the contaminated shirt and put it on the shelf. Except they get to this part and they realize the obsession is really trying to take hold, and they force themselves to either pick the top or the bottom of the stack. If it's the top, they rationalize and say that they'll wear the shirt next. And if it's the bottom, they'll rationalize that they will have forgotten about its contamination by the time they wear it. Congratulations, you have OCPD. Obviously, I can't say that. Like I said in the last question, I'm not a doctor, I can't diagnose you, but this is hilarious to me because this is me 1,000 times over. I've done this many, many times. You are not alone. You're not crazy. You might have a mental illness, but as far as it being a conscientious feature, under conscientious, you get meticulous as a personality trait. I would say that this qualifies as meticulous. So yes, I would say that that's probably the subtype or one of the subtypes that you are relating to, and possibly parsimonious. If you look that up, I think you'd find a little bit of that in there as well. But that's just, it's really funny to me because that is something I've done in the past, and hopefully I don't continue to do. And hopefully you don't continue to do. Okay, so this next question is from LF from the video, Knowing You Have OCPD is Only Scratching the Surface. Advice for people in office who have to deal with someone who might have this. Convinced a coworker has this, others are avoiding him, and he is driving me crazy for sure. Really quickly, I find this to be a slightly controversial topic because I believe that an employer has a right to hire and fire whoever they please. Somebody's poured their blood, sweat, and tears into building a business or building a product, and they shouldn't have to keep somebody on that's costing them money. That makes no sense to me. However, as a society, I think there's a lot more that we could do to support people in it with mental illnesses and disabilities in general. And as somebody with a mental illness, I see both sides of this. So I'm saying this because I think that if you have somebody that you work with that is very, very difficult, and if they're doing things that are against company policy, or their communication is something that goes against company policy as well, you are able to go to somebody above them. You're able to go to human resources and talk about them and talk about the problem. Basically, you know, somebody needs to sit down with them and let them know what's acceptable and what's not acceptable. I'm not saying that you should get this person fired or try to get this person fired, but I don't know what position you're in. So if you're in a position that you can talk to the person, go right ahead and do that. If you're not, go to somebody that is in a position to talk to them. And there's no guarantees. You know, you probably work with other people that are assholes that don't have OCPD, and that's just the way it is. But I empathize with you, and I hope that you can get the situation resolved or into a situation that is better for you. If you can reach out to the person in a kind way and you want to try that first, by all means, go ahead and do that. Okay, so we're about halfway through the questions, and I had wanted to mention at the beginning that I will include as many links as possible within the video to the other videos that I'm referencing where these questions came from. But whichever ones I'm not able to include in the video, I will put down below in the description. So I'll list the questions and I'll list the original videos so that you can check those out and get more context for the answers that I'm given today. Okay, so this is from CB from OCPD in Origin Story Part 2. This is talking about being in a relationship with someone with OCPD. What I find hardest is the lack of affection and the total prioritization of work and household tasks over us. My question is, How does love slash being in a relationship feel to someone with OCPD? And why is expressing affection so difficult? So I don't personally have an issue with this particular problem that comes up with being in a relationship with somebody with OCPD. I know that it's common. I know that a lot of people with OCPD struggle with showing affection, struggle with telling the other person that they love them, communicating in a loving manner in a relationship. For me, this is not really an issue because of the subtypes of OCPD that I have. What I do experience from time to time is trouble communicating with somebody that I'm in a relationship with. And what will happen is that I will want to talk to them about something that is bothering me, and I cannot find the words to express what I'm feeling and in a way that I think is going to be constructive. I run the conversation through my head, and every time I do, it goes horribly wrong. And so I will end up just shutting down completely. And I can go for days without talking. And eventually that leads to depression, anxiety, and those things negatively impact the relationship. And that's no fun for anyone. As far as just in general not being affectionate, that's something that people with the subtypes that generally are overworkers and have strong focus on the logical side of their brain. And this is something I'll have to go into in a video. It's something that, because I don't experience, I'm not gonna be able to just come up with something off the top of my head, and I don't wanna give you guys some BS. So I'll do a video on this question, but it's not something that everybody with OCPD experiences. So if you're in a relationship with somebody that has this, it does not necessarily mean that they can't be affectionate. So at least know that for now. KH from OCPD, an origin story part two. Hi. I'd never heard of OCPD until I received a diagnosis a few days ago. It fits me to a T, but I'm struggling with that because now I'm seeing everything about me to be considered a bad thing and part of a disorder. Do you have any advice for this or any videos on how to improve? So yeah, I do have some videos on this. So you have OCPD. What now is a video that would pertain to this. I have two videos on not making excuses about your recovery. Those would be good. And then why change my life now? Is it even possible? I believe is the title of one of the videos that I've done that I'm most proud of the way it came out. And so I would suggest those to start with. But all that aside, you are not a bad person. OCPD does not make you a bad person. Having a mental illness does not make you a bad person. The symptoms that you have, they do not make you a bad person. What more likely is the case is that you have a set of symptoms that don't fit in with society at large. And because of that, people struggle to get along with you, you struggle to get along with others, and life is very challenging. So the good news is, A, again, you're not a bad person, and B, if you've received a diagnosis and you're willing to accept the diagnosis, you can now be on a path to recovery, and that is a really great thing. And so there you go. NW says, from the video OCPD and Origin Story Part 2, the same video, do you feel that you had become abusive toward your partners through OCPD? Okay, so we're back to being serious. Yeah, I don't like the word abusive. It's a horrible, ugly word. And but this is a horrible, ugly disorder at times. And I know being in forums and groups with others, there's a lot of denial. Even once you have this disorder as to the severity of it or what we really do to other people. And a lot of people don't like to face that. It doesn't feel good. And it doesn't feel good seeing that word and thinking that I have done that. I've never been physically abusive, but I think that people have suffered because of the words that I've chosen to use in situations. And not only am I not proud of it, I don't feel good about it. I've made the apologies where necessary. A lot of the times the situation is just required moving forward and going separate paths, going separate ways, whatever. Yeah, now I'm sweating. But that's it. If you have this disorder and you've been treating people poorly, get yourself into treatment, please. NB from OCPD versus OCD, Know the Difference Part 1. There is a Part 2 to this video, and based on view counts, I don't think many of you know that. So I'd highly recommend the first video you go check out after this one. It would be the Part 2 to OCPD versus OCD, because it is considerably better than the first video. I go into a lot more detail. It's just produced better, and I'm a lot less nervous on camera because it's a video I did much later in my YouTube, whatever you want to call it, career. And so go check that out. But the question is, you can have both, right? Referring to OCPD and OCD. Yes, there is a comorbidity. It is completely possible. I'm not a doctor. I don't know what you have. You could have both. You could have neither. You can have one or the other, but go see somebody and they'll let you know what's going on with you. From the same video, OCPD versus OCD, crippling procrastination due to the fear that I may not be capable of performing the task is an OCPD or an OCD symptom, asking because of fear of doing college homework. I'm incredibly happy that I'm not the one having to do college homework. It depends. It's your thought process that governs whether or not this is OCPD versus OCD. So if you are unable to start your studying because you have to be organized and all your pens have to be in the right order and your paper has to be in the right order, and your room has to be completely tidied up, and you have to do all of these grooming habits, or whatever it is that you've got to do, those sound to me like OCD symptoms. They're causing procrastination. You're not getting to the studying. If you're procrastinating because you feel like you're going to fail at the task, so you're not going to be able to study hard enough, you're not going to be able to study long enough, you're not good enough to take this test, that sounds a lot more to me like OCPD. And so procrastination results from both. And it depends on what is going on in your head as to which one more likely is that you have. So the gist of it is, it depends on your thought process. If you have OCPD or if you have OCD, go see a therapist. They'll let you know. Maybe you have neither. Maybe you just like to procrastinate. There's plenty of those people too. And I think the lesson from this video is go see a professional. Go see a psychiatrist, a psychotherapist, even a counselor, whoever's available to talk to. And start taking steps towards feeling better and being more proactive in your treatment. Finally, getting towards the end now. This is from So You Have OCPD, What Now? I haven't been to a doctor yet, but just recently discovered this page, and I really identify with a lot of these symptoms. Does anyone think OCPD can cause a learning disability misdiagnosis? Absolutely. I was misdiagnosed with OCD. I could imagine somebody being misdiagnosed with ADHD, you know, especially in school. That's why it's important to see a doctor and somebody that knows what they're talking about, knows what they're doing, and to be very open. I think a lot of misdiagnosis comes from going and seeing a professional and then not being truthful with a professional. I have talked to a lot of people through this channel that have asked for help, and it's very difficult to help that person when they don't want to be honest with you or honest with themselves. So I know I'm going off the rails a bit here, but a misdiagnosis, I think, is common because sometimes you're not seeing the most qualified professional, but a lot of times because you're just not giving the person everything they need in order to make that proper diagnosis. But yeah, we have a lot of symptoms that could lead somebody to identify a different disorder. Next, is this related to Asperger's? No. Have you been diagnosed with Asperger's? Me? No. And I don't believe that there is a correlation. This is something that's been coming up more and more recently. I've talked about it in another video. Let's get controversial video. It's okay if you think that. It doesn't bother me, but I have looked at the information available and I do not see a correlation between the two. And I think, again, this is just looking at a symptom and not a thought process, and associating it with another disorder that really has nothing to do with the way the person is actually thinking or what's going on in their brain. So that's it for this video. Those are not all of your questions, but those are questions that came up multiple times. And so I thought we'd discuss them together. And I've got about 4 videos already. This will make number 5 that are on my computer waiting to be edited. So I'm gonna stop filming at this point for a while and I'm gonna get completely caught up that way. As I film a video, I can release it that same week. It'll be a lot more beneficial to the health of this channel if the videos that you're watching are close in time to when they were actually filmed. They'll make a lot more sense. I don't know that you guys even need to know this, but that's where we are with this channel. So as of this video coming out, I should be completely caught up, and you should expect more regular content from me. I hope you guys enjoyed this. Leave all your questions, all your thoughts, hit that like button. Don't forget to subscribe. I'm still Daryl. This is still My Life in Debris, and I'll see you guys in the next video.